Okay, thanks a lot for the introduction. So what's the IQ of AI? That's not just the theme of the conference over here. That's also the same question Alan Turing asked himself 70 years back. So he created this famous Turing test, which used conversational capabilities to judge essentially the IQ or the progress of AI. At the same time, also 70 years ago, Fraunhofer was founded, which is meanwhile the largest applied research organization in Europe. So you can imagine that those two themes are now going together, and conversational AI is a big topic at Fraunhofer. So what I want to do in the talk is to give you a glimpse, an overview of what we are doing at Fraunhofer at the moment, so where we are standing in terms of conversational AI, and what next steps we want to do. So the things I'm presenting here are actually created in two different institutes. That's on the one side, Fraunhofer IIS, which is the largest Fraunhofer institute with more than 1,000 employees and very famous for audio processing. For instance, they have contributed significantly to the MP3 and AAC codecs. And on the other hand, we have our institute, Fraunhofer IAIS. So we are a core AI institute at Fraunhofer with more than 300 people working on data science and AI. And in terms of conversational AI, we have our strengths in question answering, knowledge graphs, and speech recognition. So when I talk at least about conversational AI, I mean this as an umbrella term for chatbots, speech assistants, smart assistants, and other words which are used. And to simplify it and fit the talk into 15 minutes, I broke this up into three steps, which you can see here. And I will go through those one by one and show a bit the technology we have. So we start on the left with processing an audio signal. So we assume that there is some user using his own voice as input for a speech assistant. And the goal is to transform this into a text. So there are two steps which are important here. So the first step is that you need a clear voice signal. So for this, the colleagues at Fraunhofer IIS have developed up here, voice quality enhancement technology, which essentially cancels out all the noise, it removes acoustic echoes, and basically extracts the voice signal from the overall audio signal. So this technology is in place, or has been developed over a long time, and is now very mature, integrated in various products. As you can see, it's used at Yandex, LG, and other products. So since I'm not from IIS, I can say for them that it's a world-leading technology, and they are among the best in this field. So once we have this clear voice signal, the next step is to actually convert it into a text. So this is based of course, on speech recognition. I will play you a brief video here, and you can see the live subtitles coming from the speech recognition software.
Look now at what Prime Minister May is facing in the way of opposition within her own ranks.
Brexit means Brexit. Brexit means Brexit, and we're going to make a success of it.
So Brexit wasn't quite the success she hoped for, but but you could see the speech recognition working. It works live, so you can translate in real time with less than 1 second delay. And yeah, the most important aspect of speech recognition is the word error rate, so how many mistakes does the system make. And nowadays, the systems developed at Fraunhofer are leading in German, so they have the lowest word error rate in this language, and they are competitive in English compared to Google Cloud API and others. So of course, it also depends a bit on how you measure and in which circumstances. So the systems can also adapt to specific vocabulary. So for instance, we have Brexit as a term here. So you can tell the system that it should support this kind of keywords. And those systems are running, as Professor Froebel also said in his initial keynote, at 24/7 at German broadcasters, and not only doing speech recognition, but also tasks which go beyond this. So once we have converted this audio signal into text, we are coming to the core dialogue system. So that's actually where the real magic happens and where the intelligence of the system is sort of decided. So there is a huge variety of things you can do in the core dialogue system. So I will just focus on one type of dialogue system, and those are so-called sequential question answering systems. So how do those systems work? So first of all, if you want to have an intelligent conversational AI system, it usually needs to have some sort of knowledge. So we've heard about this theme of hybrid AI already in several other talks. So it's very important to be able to connect deep learning approaches, which are used in every step here, with expert and domain knowledge. And one thing which we are frequently using are so-called knowledge graphs. So for those of you who don't know them yet, they are pretty straightforward. So you can really see them as graphs, and the nodes are real entities like Brandenburg Gate and Karl Gotthard Langhans here. And the edges describe the relations between those nodes. So the edge in the middle here says that Karl Gotthard Langhans is the architect of Brandenburg Gate. So of course, we can also put a lot of things on top of those simple knowledge graphs, as was discussed in the keynote on Psych in the morning. So there's a lot of logical elements you can add on top. But in the simplest case, we just have knowledge graphs. And in many use cases, there's domain knowledge, which can be modeled on those knowledge graphs, usually by combining several sources, sometimes even from several organizations. And those knowledge graphs can grow very large, up to billions of facts. So sequential answering is then essentially about asking questions against this knowledge graph. So I have one example here. So you can see a conversation in a car. So the person's asking what the fancy building on the left is. System responds. Then the user has a follow-up question. So why is this building famous? Again, the system responds. And the user may have yet another follow-up question and ask about the architect of the building. So you can see various challenges here. So if you look at the first question, for instance, the user is asking about the building to his or her left. So for this sort of question, the system needs to have some context knowledge. So it needs to know, for instance, the position of the car, or needs to have some visual clues on what to actually be able to answer the question correctly. The second question needs so-called coreference. So you have this word it in there. So I've heard of it. Why is it famous? And here we need to figure out that this actually refers to the answer of the previous question, so Brandenburg Gate. A question answering system now needs to identify this entity, Brandenburg Gate, and in addition, it also needs to figure out the right relation, which could be famous for or something like this in this case. And once it has done this, it can send a query against the knowledge graph and get the response back. So the third question is even a bit trickier, because there you need to go via multiple hops in the knowledge graph. So starting from Brandenburg Gate, you first need to get the architect of this, and then for the architect, you need to get the birthplace. So that's like a two-hop step which you need to do in those queries. And of course, we are developing both more classical systems, modular systems for such use cases, where you have a lot of components, which we are all training individually. And this works pretty well in practice. So we're also working on end-to-end systems, which you just can train with raw dialogues, as you can see them here. Those are more a topic for research at the moment. So with those systems, we do not get very consistent, coherent dialogues yet. So, but I think that's something for the next 5 years. And not just for us, but also for pretty much all conversational agents, that's true. So now that we have a core dialogue system component, the last step is to actually transform the text which we're getting from this component into voice again. So there was a breakthrough in end of 2016 here by DeepMind. So they developed WaveNet, which is based on a large convolutional neural network, and could create very natural sounding voice. So we've heard it in the Amazon talk before, actually, or heard something very similar on the talk before. And the challenge in the past years was essentially to get this to run efficiently in real time. I can play one example here.
The museum is subdivided into the Antiquity Collection, the Middle East Museum, and the Museum of Islamic Art.
So you can hear that it sounds pretty natural. So it's very hard to distinguish from a human nowadays. And at Fraunhofer, we have developed similar technologies and are pretty much on a similar level to Google, Amazon, and others in this field. So those were some of the key technology components. Of course, we're all putting them together in various use cases. So this use case for which I had the example on the previous slide can actually be tested here. So you can just go to the back and we have a virtual reality headset which you can put on. Then you are in the middle of Berlin, actually pretty close to where we physically are at the moment, but that's just a coincidence. And then you can drive around in a car and ask questions about some sites in the city. And that's more or less a sequential question answering scenario which we demonstrate there. So we also showed this at Hannover Messe in together with Volkswagen. Of course, there was no space for a car, so we just have a seat there and can try it in the seat. Okay, so I showed some of the technologies which we are developing at Fraunhofer. The other question is, where do we want to go in the future? And yeah, we talked to a lot of different companies over the past 2 years. And for most of them, digital sovereignty was a key word and was a very important key term. So most companies want full control over their data. They actually also want that their users have full control over the data they have. Many of them want to be independent of cloud providers, or at least of non-German or non-European cloud providers. Some want to host systems entirely on-premise. And aspects like data security and privacy, full GDPR, or in Germany, DSGVO compliance, are also pretty important. So one thing we are trying to push in the future is to support this digital sovereignty by providing a German or European alternative speech assistant platform. So all of the things I've shown are purely developed by Fraunhofer and do not have any dependency on non-German or non-European components. On the other hand, of course, we also want to be leading in the field, because if the quality of systems is too low, then we also wouldn't get new projects and have users. So we are pretty advanced in terms of the individual components, but we didn't have a platform yet where we could integrate all of this. But that's exactly what we will do in the next 3 years. So we will start the speaker project in April next year. And that's a platform which unifies those components which I've shown here, plus many others, in a speech assistant platform. So we have a business focus. We're actually not focusing the users of Google Assistant and other tools. So we are really trying to build a domain-specific conversational AI systems for organizations. So inside of the platform, we both have modules, as I've shown, but we also will have a data platform which you can use to trade or exchange training data and background knowledge. And what's probably most interesting for you is that you can actually try out the system, or we'll be able to try out the system next year. So we'll have a speaker test space where both research organizations and selected companies can actually test the components. And using this, you can assess the technology before we go live in 2022. So those are the organizations developing the platform. So at the core, there are our two Fraunhofer institutes. Then we have 20 other partners developing use cases, modules, and so on. And at the moment, we have 30 more associated partners, as you can see on the slide. But this network will essentially grow over the next 3 years. OK, so since I just have less than 1 minute, I want to wrap up the talk and also maybe wrap up the session a little bit. So I believe that text and voice interaction has become very important and will become even more important, because it's just the most direct way of communication for us as humans. So unless we can read thoughts, which we may not even want to do, this is just the easiest way to communicate. So at Fraunhofer, we emphasize digital sovereignty and also want to be competitive in terms of core technologies with the other providers out there. And coming back to the main theme, what's the IQ of AI? I would say that in terms of conversational AI, we are now getting pretty good at narrow AI. So we can I developed domain-specific use cases very well. So technologies have improved significantly there over the past 5 to 10 years. It's still pretty hard to develop a generic hard AI. So I don't see this coming in the next few years, because we simply need a lot of domain and expert knowledge, at least in the use cases we are supporting. So at the moment, there's no conversational AI which is as versatile, universal, and flexible as humans. So thank you.